Several progressive groups staged an indignation rally in Quezon City following the acquittal of retired Army Major General Jovito Palparan over the kidnapping and torture of two farmers back in 2006. The court had raised doubts over the statements and account of the surviving complainant, Raymond Manalo. Manalo could not contain his disappointment over the decision, but assures that he will continue to seek justice.
Ituloy ang laban, hindi ako titigil, hindi ako susuko hanggang hindi ko nakakamit ang tunay na justisya para sa akin, para pa rin sa ibang mga kasamahan kong mga nalabagang karapatang pagtaas.
Attorney Julian Oliva Jr. of the National Union of People's Lawyers, meanwhile, says they will seek all remedies to get justice for the Manalos.
Isang remedy pang na binibigay dun sa mga nagreklamo para iporso yung kaso nila kahit na hindi papasok yan bilang double jeopardy. Siguro yung unang ano, yung unang gagawin namin, motion for reconsideration by, sa kaso. Dahil meron kaming written authority mula sa office ng provincial prosecutor ng Bulacan.
Five candidates for the Village and Youth Council polls face disqualification due to allegations of vote buying. Our correspondent Victoria Tula joins us more for the details. Victoria.
That's correct, Rica. The Commission on Elections Committee on Contrabigay has filed petitions for disqualification against a village chief candidate in Samar, in Quezon Province, Maguindanao del Norte, and Marikina because of reports of vote buying. One candidate for village councillor in Marikina is also facing a case. The committee filed the petitions before the clerk of COMELEC yesterday. According to Rafael Olaño, COMELEC deputy executive director for operations, the candidate in Quezon province was reportedly allowed by the local government unit to participate in a relief distribution event where that person declared that he was running. In Samar, a candidate sponsored the food of some officials in a resort. While in Marikina, the candidate for village chief and village councillor allegedly gave 1,500 pesos to residents. COMELEC has sent a copy of the petitions to the respondents who have 5 days to respond. On Monday, cases will be raffled to a division. With or without the reply of a respondent, the hearing will proceed. There are 41 more petitions regarding vote buying to be filed, but Olaño expects more complaints to come in. Commissioner Ernesto Maceda Jr., commissioner in charge of the committee, emphasized the seriousness of COMELEC in going after vote buying and selling. He also warned local government officials.
Yun naman hong mga local officials din mismo, kung pasaway naman ho sila ng ganyan at isasama na, titignan ho rin namin kung paano ho natin, pag-aaralan ho namin kung paano sila mapagsasabihan o magagawan ho ng kaukulang aksyon.
Meron po nakalagay doon na petition with motion to suspend proclamation ad cautelam. Ibig pong sabihin nun, halimbawa po, pending pa yung case nung magkaroon ng eleksyon at nanalo yung respondent dito sa kaso, so ipapasuspend po muna yung kanilang proclamation. So ibig sabihin, they will not be proclaimed until after ma-decide yung kaso against them.
Meanwhile, COMELEC has also ordered elections technology company Smartmatic to comment on the petition seeking its disqualification from bidding for the 2025 elections. The poll body has also set the first hearing on the case on September 17 or October 17. Petitioners, one of which is former DICT Secretary Eliseo Rio Jr., claim that Smartmatic failed to deliver in the 2022 elections, thus resulting in irregularities. Rica?
Hi, Vicky. Just one question. Those who are facing disqualification cases still have a chance to prove their actions otherwise?
Yes, Rica. This is why the COMELEC Committee on Contrabigay has sent them a copy of the cases against them. So they have 5 days from the receipt of the order to reply or to respond. And they will have also the chance to explain their side during the hearing that will be set in the coming days.
Would you know how many candidates now have already received cases of disqualification?
For vote buying, Mika, there are only 5 as of the moment which have been filed. And for there's also the committee on or the task force anti-EPAL, which is now handling premature campaigning cases, and they have sent, if I'm not mistaken, more than 50 petitions, or they have also filed more than 50 petitions for disqualification, and they have informed the respondents about that.
All right, a comprehensive report coming from you. Thank you so much, Victoria Tulan. Tensions again escalating over at the West Philippine Sea. The Philippine Coast Guard protests attempts by the Chinese Coast Guard to block a mission by four ships to resupply troops on Manila's lone outpost at Ayungin Shoal. Our correspondent Jackie Manabat joins us on the line with that story. Jackie.
Rica, the Philippine Coast Guard raised concerns over harassment by the Chinese vessels during a resupply mission on October 4, Wednesday. The Philippine Coast Guard ships were escorting two indigenous boats carrying supplies to troops stationed at the BRP Sierra Madre in Ayungin Shoal on Wednesday. The agency said it was the first time that a China Coast Guard vessel dangerously approached a bow of a PCG ship coming within a mere meter of the ship. An incident marked the closest proximity they encountered during their resupply missions. It was also the first time that a People's Liberation Army Navy vessel went as near as 800 meters away from the Philippine ship. Last Wednesday's supply run, the Chinese vessels intercepted the Philippine Coast Guard ships at least nine times. The Chinese vessels also followed the Philippine Coast Guard ships three times and dangerously maneuvered their own ship eight times. The Philippines had two Coast Guard ships and two boats carrying supplies, while China had four China Coast Guard ships, five Chinese maritime militia vessels, and one People's Liberation Army vessel. Commodore Jay Tariela, spokesperson for the Philippine Coast Guard West Philippine Sea, stated that their role in the resupply mission is to act as an escort vessel, leaving the strategic approach to the armed forces of the Philippines. Manila's special envoy to Beijing, Teodoro Locsin Jr., joined the resupply mission and witnessed firsthand China's dangerous maneuvers. Compared to previous resupply missions, the number of Chinese vessels approaching the Philippine Coast Guard's ships has increased. This includes a Chinese fishing vessel that is now part of the blockade. The Chinese fishing vessels have been included in the count of the Philippine Coast Guard as part of the Chinese maritime militia. Commodore Jay Tariela stated that despite China's denial that they are just ordinary fishermen, they can be seen swarming various maritime features within the Philippines' exclusive economic zone, or EEZ. He also noted that in the past two operations, these fishing vessels, now considered as Chinese maritime militia, appeared to be taking command from the China Coast Guard in blocking the Philippine Coast Guard ships. According to a statement posted on the China Coast Guard's website, they issued warnings and conducted necessary control of four Filipino vessels that entered Ayungin Shoal without the approval of the Chinese government. Commodore Jay Tariela emphasized that they do not need permission from China, as the Philippines has uncontested sovereign rights over these waters. Based on the 2016 arbitral ruling in favor of the Philippines, Ayungin Shoal is within the country's exclusive economic zone. Ayungin Shoal is located 200 kilometers away from Palawan and over 1,000 kilometers away from mainland China. And despite the repeated blockades entailing by Chinese vessels, the Philippine Coast Guard said it will continue to accompany the boats carrying supplies to the troops stationed at the BRP Sierra Madre in Ayungin Shoal. Back to you, Rica.
Thank you so much, Jackie Manabat, reporting live. More development projects seen in Pagasa Island. Philippine lawmakers visited the island on Thursday to monitor the ongoing construction of a sheltered port where fisherfolk can take refuge during typhoons. House Speaker Martin Romualdez admits the realignment they made from the secret funds of civilian agencies are insufficient to fund other projects in the West Philippine Sea. But he says lawmakers are looking for other ways to support the community there.
Asahan ng ano yung buong pag-asa at Kalayan Island Group that help and support is on the way. Baka mayroon pa tayong mahihabol dito sa BICAM na yung mga priority na natulong.
Meanwhile, the Philippines' armed forces aiming to make their presence in the West Philippine Sea permanent to assure fishermen of their safety amid China's intimidation.
Kailangan tuloy-tuloy yung pag-develop natin dito dahil gusto natin na maging permanent yung ating presence dito sa West Philippine Sea. So kailan gawin nating habitable yung mga isla na ito. Inaantay natin yung mga karagdagang mga barko natin. And hopefully by next year, dumating itong mga barko, we will have more patrols in the area.
All 42 commercial airports under the Civil Aviation Authority of the Philippines on heightened alert following bomb threats. Air traffic services received a warning via email that aircraft from Manila bound for Puerto Princesa, Mactan, Cebu, Bicol, and Davao International Airports will be set off by a bomb. CAAP says aviation personnel are collaborating closely with the Philippine National Police Aviation Security Group and military authorities to intensify intelligence and monitoring operations. It adds, no flight schedules will be affected despite the heightened alert status. It also warns false bomb threat violators, they may face up to 5 years of imprisonment.
Sa ngayon, wala pang recommendations sa ibang personnel namin sa mga airports. Depende na yan sa airport manager kung na-assist niya na kuhan. Pero ngayon, wala pa naman. We are in normal mode. We assure you that our airport security personnel are vigilant on this. And we try as much as possible na hindi ma-disrupt yung ating mga operations yan.
The Philippine Privacy Commission warns PhilHealth members of possible fraud and phishing attacks after the cyber attack on the state insurer. Attorney Michael Santos, chief of the NPC's Complaints and Investigation Division, advises PhilHealth members to monitor any illegal access attempts and be cautious of unregistered numbers trying to get their personal information. Santos says verification of the leaked details are still ongoing.
Even over the weekend, may directive kami to work and to find out kasi this is a matter of great importance. No? Yung privacy ng ating mga kababayan, yung personal na information ay hindi basta-basta. So kung ito'y pinangangalagaan, ang investigasyon dito ay dapat tuloy-tuloy at sa lalong madaling panahon.
A cybercrime lawyer says the culprits of the PhilHealth ransomware attack are not the only ones liable in the law, but also the people responsible for keeping the leaked data. According to UP College of Law professor attorney Oliver Xavier Reyes, personnel in charge of storing the members' information can also be criminally and administratively liable once negligence has been proven on their part. He adds this may also include the officers and chief of the agency. Reyes reiterates, government agencies must ramp up measures in securing data against ransomware attacks.
Talagang dapat conscious yung mga magmula sa head ng agencies, magmula sa mga individual managers na namamahala ng mga data. Dapat conscious talaga sila na baka tamaan sila, baka targets talaga sila. And therefore, yung infrastructure for investment sa mga cybersecurity programs such as mga antivirus na software. Mm-hmm. At hindi lamang yun. Kailangan magkaroon din talaga ng kultura ng cybersecurity sa mga bawat mga ahensya.
80,000 Marawi siege victims still left without homes nearly 6 years after the 5-month-long armed conflict ended. They're now appealing to the government to fulfill its promise to rehabilitate the war-torn city. Job Manahan with that story.
In 2017, the countless bullets and bombs almost pulverized over a dozen villages here in this area of Marawi City. The fierce fighting between government forces and Islamic State-aligned militants turned homes and structures to rubble. The city's mosque was not spared. For 5 months, the premier Islamic city of the Philippines became a war zone. But nearly 6 years since its liberation, some displaced residents say little has changed in their personal situation. While the results of recovery efforts can be seen with the businesses reopening and the economy humming again, some affected locals say they're still homeless. One of them is Anisa. She turned emotional as she recalled the pain of losing her home and the challenges she constantly has to face. Anisa is living in a permanent shelter in Sagiaran, Lanao del Sur. She has 8 children, one of whom has special needs. Her husband died shortly after the siege. Despite the lack of water supply in the shelter, she says this is better compared to her previous situation.
Hirap na po kami, sir. Kung saan sana ako makarating, mabuhay ko lang yung mga anak ko. Wala po akong trabaho, wala akong anak buhay masyado. Umiintay po kami sa mga awa ng kamag-anak. Ganun po. Sino ba na ang tatakbuhan ko, sir? Wala akong tatay, wala akong magulang na tatakbuhan ko, wala akong kapatid. Yun lang. Sabi ko sa mga anak ko, kumayod na lang kung ano man yung pwede natin ikabuhay.
For Hani, a community leader, she's still waiting for government to make good on its promise to provide housing. She wants government to turn over land ownership to Marawi residents. Otherwise, she says, she will never be truly home.
Naranasan ko yung paiba-iba ako ng lugar. Palipat-lipat ako kung saan-saan. Dahil hindi ako pwedeng magstay sa isang lugar na alam ko naman na hindi ako pwedeng mabuhay doon. Kasi hinahanap-hanap ko yung dating buhay namin sa Marawi. Before, nahihirapan kami kahit na mayroon kaming sinasabing permanent shelter. Of course, di namin matatawag ito na permanente hanggat hindi po namin naisasakamay ang sinasabi nila land of title. Ang tanging pinangahawakan lang po namin is yung certification of house and land.
Community leaders say government must be held accountable for their situation. What they want is a safe, dignified, and voluntary return to Marawi City.
No, kasi yung mga problemang ito, itong mga problema sa contract of lease na marami nang nag-end this year at yung iba soon to end this year. So hindi alam ng mga IDPs saan sila pupulutin, saan naman sila magte-transfer after mag-end ang kanilang contract of lease. Dapat makita natin ano ba yung nagkulang, ano ba yung sino ba yung maging accountable? Bakit nagkasira-sira ang itong rehabilitation.
On October 17, 2017, then President Rodrigo Duterte declared the liberation of Marawi. Data gathered by stakeholders, however, showed around 80,000 individuals or 16,000 families are still living outside the city or with their relatives. Less than 100 families were able to return to ground zero. The Marawi Compensation Board said they need 50 billion pesos to compensate all the families affected by the 2017 Marawi siege. In the 2024 budget, however, only 1 billion pesos have been allotted for the agency. From July 4 to August 31, around 4,762 or 19.58% have already filed claims amounting to 17.46 billion pesos.
Yung Marawi Compensation Board, ang ultimate goal talaga niya is kambalingan, meaning to return home. So, yung po-provide na compensation, it may not be enough kasi we know that there are so many non-compensatory pa na kailangan. Like, what we are hearing during the adjudication, ang dami pala na intervention na hindi pa natin magagawa. Like psychosocial healing.
Interior Undersecretary Margarita Gutierrez says there are still some issues that need to be ironed out, such as land disputes. She adds, it is important to hold constant dialogue with stakeholders so the proper agencies can address problems on the ground.
I think with that po, we need to ask help po from other agencies para ho magkaroon ng dialogue po with these people po para ho malaman namin kung paano ba namin ma-address at ma-harmonize po yun. Actually, talagang priority ho dapat natin yung land dispute na yan. I think yan yung mga unang concern na dapat matugunan kasi yun lagi yung sinasabi nila, gusto na nilang bumalik sa bahay nila, sa buhay nila dati.
The Global Community Engagement and Resilience Fund, or GSERF, is among the organizations that is helping Marawi communities affected by the siege. Other sectors and civil society groups are also encouraged to continue helping internally displaced persons in Marawi. For those from ground zero still struggling to get back on their feet, government should look beyond just giving them homes, since the siege not only ruined people's lives, it also destroyed their future. Job Manahan, EBS-CBN News, Marawi.